I wanted to start off with a quote. It's somewhat provocative, obviously, but I figure there's more than a few lawyers in the audience, and you're used to provocative quotes and people saying provocative things. And I think part of this is possibly like a generational gap, because back in my heyday, before I actually went into psychiatry, I knew about Thomas Szasz, so probably we'll be identifying the more senior people in here who know about Szasz, but he was kind of the anti-psychiatrist. And he wrote a book called The Myth of Mental Illness, if you're interested. But I thought this was a good quote just to show we're not talking about competency in a vacuum, that there's a philosophy behind it, and there's a philosophy behind actually not having competency too. So anyway, I'll just say the quote. I think you have copies of it, but Szasz said, there are reasonably clear criteria for judging competence in such matters as pitching baseball, removing a brain tumor, or preparing a fine meal. When it comes to judging ability to stand trial, we seem to be at sea with no compass to guide us. This is due largely to the introduction of psychiatric methods and criteria into areas where they are not needed and do not belong. The assertion that a defendant is mentally unfit to stand trial is always a strategic ploy. So this explaining that one quote would take the whole hour, but you're welcome. I could give you the reference. You're welcome to read it on your own. But I think that just kind of lays a groundwork, you know, that theoretically there may not even be anything called competency. But the next slide will I think talk a little bit about some of the data behind the competency or CST, competency to stand trial. And then I'll talk a little bit about, I think in the bottom of this slide, why another philosophy as to why it is important to have competency. So I'm sure most of you know competency to stand trial is the most common forensic evaluation that's done. And out of 100 clients that a lawyer will see on average, 10 to 15 of those clients will be referred for a competency evaluation. And this is an old number. The 60,000 a year is probably about 10 years ago, so it's probably quite a bit more than that now. And getting back to the Szasz quote, there is an argument to say we should have a competency, because what if you have a severely intellectually impaired person, which used to be called mental retardation, now it's called intellectual disability. So you have somebody with a relatively low IQ who doesn't really understand what's going on, and then all of a sudden this person is declared guilty, and, you know, to make it very dramatic, is put to death for a capital crime. That doesn't seem to be just intuitively very dignified. And then the second philosophical notion for competency is that you want some reliability in the court proceedings. So I need to be able to tell my lawyer what actually went on in terms of my charge and my offense. And if I'm not able to tell the lawyer accurately what happened, then we don't have any reliability in the proceedings. And then thirdly, this is possibly the most abstract notion. There's a notion of that the client should have some autonomy. So even though, you know, hopefully I know a little bit about medicine and psychiatry, maybe a little more than all of you do, but on the other hand, my lawyer knows much more than me about the legal proceedings, and I'm trusting that lawyer to take care of technical issues during my trial. But in the end, I'm supposed, at least in theory, if I'm the defendant, I'm supposed to be the one actually making the decision autonomously. So I have to decide, do I want a jury trial? Do I want a judge? Do I want to plea? And that's supposed to be my decision as the defendant or client. So if I'm not able to do that, then we don't have competency in the proceedings. And the asterisk says, interestingly, surveys show lawyers have a far greater percentage of cases they are concerned about CST, but utilize other means. So that, another example, I don't mean to pick on the mentally retarded, mentally ill, but somebody with an intellectual disability, and say that person has an IQ of about 60, so they kind of know what's going on, but not exactly. So an example of that would be if there's a relatively benign charge, possibly a misdemeanor, and the lawyer would think, and I think rightly so, in theory, I should get a competency evaluation, but this is not really worth it. It's just going to take time. It's going to take money. And let's just talk to that person's family and let them kind of help with the decision making. And other statistics about competency is that out of 100 clients that are referred for competency, 75 will be declared competent and 25 will end up being declared incompetent to stand trial. And the most common diagnoses for CST are psychosis, and that would be mainly schizophrenia, so that would be a chronic psychosis. And again, it's kind of common sense, so it's basically saying, then I'm going to show you the statute, but I'm sure most of you know it already. So if I'm not able to have a rational understanding of what's going on because I'm hearing voices or I feel like people are out to get me, or I feel like the computer, the TV set is putting ideas in my mind, obviously I can't rationally know what's going on in my trial and assist my attorney. So it's kind of common sense to think that psychosis or schizophrenia will be the number one diagnosis for CST. And I already talked about mental retardation, or now called IDD. And third in the top three is organic brain syndrome, which is now called neurocognitive disorder in our diagnostic manual. So in the old days, that would have been somebody with dementia. So if you have somebody with a very severe dementia and their memory faculties are not very good, obviously, they're not going to know what's going on and they would be potentially incompetent. In terms of the least common diagnosis for CST referral, we're looking at substance use disorder. So that'd be an example of somebody who has a DWI charge because I'm drinking that night. And if I'm not a chronic alcoholic and I haven't already messed up my brain, when the alcohol clears my system, then I'm good to go. Now I'm thinking quite rationally. So substance abuse disorders are the least common diagnosis for CST referral. And the most common charges that the lawyer will send a client for CST are mainly violent offenses like murder or rape. And again, that's commonsensical. I'm sure most of you know that already or do it, because I'm going to have my bar is going to be much lower to send somebody for a competency exam because it's a much more dramatic and serious charge against that person. And then finally, the most significant socioeconomic predictor would be employment status. And again, if you think it through, somebody who's employed, and most jobs require some degree of being able to communicate with other people and to be able to think relatively rationally. So in order to hold that job, my thinking has to be pretty good to begin with. So that would be a predictor of people who are sent for competency who are employed tend to end up being called competent, whereas people who are unemployed, they have more of a tendency to be called incompetent. And this walks you through. The prior slide was the diagnoses for CST referral. These are the actual symptoms that are the most common for incompetency. So again, it's just common sense. In schizophrenia, there's a terminology of positive and negative symptoms. So a negative symptom of a schizophrenic would be somebody who's apathetic and they're anhedonic. So their personality is kind of more blasé. Those are the negative symptoms, whereas the positive symptoms have traditionally been delusions. So that would be like a paranoid delusion, somebody is out to get me. Or hallucination means that I'm imagining something perceptually, so that'd be hearing voices. So again, it's common sense. If I walk into a courtroom and I feel that everybody here is out to get me, I'm not going to really know what's going on. or if I'm constantly thinking that the television set is implanting ideas in my mind, again, I can't have a rational understanding of what's happening. And the fourth commonest symptom is mania. So obviously, if I'm in a manic episode, I'm not going to be too rational. And again, we can go through, you know, you can look at the slide on your own. But you are including incoherent speech and uncooperative behavior. Again, those are prominent symptoms involved with incompetency. And this particular slide, I made a handout, so you don't. I'm sure most of you know it. I don't know if you have it totally memorized, but I made the handout so we don't have to go over all the details. But I kind of gave you the Cliff's Note version here. So Dusky, even though it's such an old case, is still the standard definition of competency, and in the Texas statute, like most states, goes off of the Dusky Supreme Court ruling. And again, there's not time to go into all these in detail, but the Wilson case had to do with a person might have amnesia for what happened to them during the alleged offense, but they could still potentially be competent. Jackson versus Indiana talked about how much time it would take to restore somebody who's incompetent to competency. So you can't say, as an examiner, I can't say, well, they'll eventually be restored, but it's going to take 18 years. I'm not allowed to do that. It has to be a reasonable amount of time. And I think in the Texas statute, the term is in a foreseeable future. And I tried to simplify. This looks a little complicated, but if you could bear with me, the Dusky test is the white writing. So I'm just going to say the words in white: sufficient present ability to consult with his lawyer with a reasonable degree of rational understanding. So if you break this thing down, but again, I'm not a lawyer. I don't have any real legal background, but just from reading the articles in some common sense viewpoint, sufficient is not totally complete. So to have a sufficient understanding is that I'm not totally impaired. So it's kind of a low bar to have a sufficient. Present means that it's your current mental state, and I'm sure most of you know. An insanity plea would be what happened during the alleged offense, whereas competency is in the here and now. But the way the courts have interpreted it, and I think it's correct, present also includes the immediate future. So to give an example, you'd be talking about somebody who might be on antipsychotic medications, and they want to go off their meds. And I know as a clinician that in about a week they're going to be looking kind of, if I can use the term, batshit crazy. So we need to include the immediate present in the definition of competency. And then the word ability means that you're functioning at least adequately. So again, you don't have to be functioning at some high IQ like I'm sure everybody in here has, but I have to have some low standard of ability, and it cannot be due to being unfamiliar with the courtroom. So to use kind of a example that's in the news nowadays, if you had somebody from another country who immigrated and they really don't understand our setup here, just because they're unfamiliar with the setup doesn't mean they're incompetent. So we're allowed to explain to them, well, there's this person called a judge and there's these other people called lawyers, and we explain that to them so that they become familiar. That's a reasonable way to proceed. Excuse me. And then another reason that you cannot call somebody incompetent just because they choose not to to involve themselves in the process. So that happens, I'd say, maybe about 10% of the prisoners I see at Travis County. I basically go through security and I walk over to their cell, and you know, somebody escorts me, and there's this prisoner who's, you know, might be bare naked or under a blanket, and I say, by the way, I'm Dr. Weiss, and your attorney so and so sent me, and they just basically say, F you, I'm not participating. They go back to their bench, and now they're taking a nap. Well, that doesn't mean they're incompetent. That just means that they've chosen not to participate, and they still might be declared competent. And then the last part of this prong is to consult with his lawyer with a reasonable degree of rational understanding. So again, that's a low bar. It has to be somebody who has at least a tiny bit of an ability to abstract, a little bit more than concrete, but again, that person can still be competent even though they have a very concrete understanding. As long as their understanding is rote, that's good enough for the statute. And then the second prong of the statute is designated by the word and. So the second part is and whether he has a rational as well as factual understanding of the proceedings against him. So the and sentence denotes that both things have to be satisfied. So if the person does not have a sufficient present ability to consult with his lawyer, or they do not have a rational as well as factual understanding of the proceedings, if either one of those are not satisfied, then they're supposed to be declared incompetent. And then on further Supreme Court ruling in Drope added another prong where the court said the person, in order to be competent, has to otherwise be able to assist with his defense. And I wanted to point out, again, it's in the more complicated slide in your handouts of the various landmark decisions, that in the Godinez versus Moran, again, I'm not a lawyer, but just common sense tells you, Justice Thomas wrote, the decision to plead guilty is no more complicated than the sum total of decisions during the course of a trial. There's no reason to believe that the decision to waive counsel requires a higher level of mental functioning. So again, as a lay person, I kind of understand the superficial reason. It kind of seems like if I can sit there and understand a trial, then I probably can know what a plea is and all of that type of thing. But I feel in a deeper reading of these various functions, it just seems like common sense. Like it's a lot easier to sit here and basically understand what's going on in my trial, and it may be much more difficult to understand what a complex plea is. So I'm going to go into that a little bit more later. Excuse me. And these are the considerations for a referral. So that would be you lawyers, or mainly lawyers in the audience. You think you want to get a competency referral on a client. And as an example, let's say that happens to be an 8-year-old kid. So you're probably, if you do have a pool of, hopefully we're relatively good experts, but you have one expert who does mainly child psychology or child psychiatry, you're probably going to want to send in that person. And then there's the whole notion of cultural competence. That's, again, something in the news quite a bit with culture nowadays. And again, it's kind of like a common sense, obvious thing. So if you have a forensic psychologist who speaks Spanish and you have a Spanish-speaking person in the jail, you probably are going to tend to want to send in that particular person. And I wanted to also put in a remark for private referrals, even though we wouldn't have a private referral in this particular system of Travis County. I occasionally do get a private referral, and obviously you want to whereas we're paid here a set amount for each competency exam, you're going to want to set your fee with your examiner before they head out to do it. So what would be an inappropriate referral? And that would be, for instance, if you send your forensic psychologist or psychiatrist out to do a competency exam, but you really want that person to get some information about whether or not the client was insane at the time of the offense. You're not really supposed to do that. And again, similarly, you're not supposed to send an examiner out there just because you want some information for plea bargaining or sentencing. You're not supposed to ethically order a competency exam just for the sake of delaying a trial. And you, this would be something more on the part of the examiner. I want to avoid having a dual role. So in this case, a dual role means that I actually treated that client. So that client actually had been my patient or is my patient. And I'm not really supposed to now be also the forensic expert. That would be called a dual role. And then finally, lawyers sometimes send examiners out for competency evaluations. And it's really just because the lawyer knows that that person in jail is very psychotic or very depressed, and the mental health team is taking their time seeing that person. So that's kind of an easy way. They call it a backdoor to get some clinical treatment. And I'm sure none of this will be surprising to most of you, but the asterisk in blue says that judges often grant competency motion despite misgivings in order to avoid post-conviction appeal. And again, they're really not supposed to do that as far as I can tell from my reading, but it's just human nature. And then finally, you're not supposed to send me out in one of your ploys, if I can put it that way, because you're kind of just using me. And the way I can guard against it is I can talk to the lawyer and find out exactly why you're sending me out there. And this is a very good, I just wanted to put in a pitch for the cultural competency that I can give you the reference on this. And it's a very good manual. And this person actually is at University of Texas at the Hogg Foundation, they call it. So I'm going to go through this very quickly because I assume 99% of you know this already, that what's human sources am I going to use when I go out for my evaluation? Hopefully I'm going to know something from the referring attorney. I'm going to know something from the prosecuting attorney. I might get some information directly from the judge. I might be able to talk to the client's family. I walk in and I talk to the jail staff. But the main take-home point is that multiple sources improve accuracy, and that's kind of an obvious point. And then in terms of documents, in this particular system, I found actually it is very efficient, and it's become even more efficient because we have one person, Ashley, who usually we just, as soon as we get the request for the competency, we just email Ashley, and within 24 hours, we get the OR and the mental health records from the court. So that's really great. And again, it's just common sense. If that client has been hospitalized multiple times, it'd be great to get the hospital records, or if they've been treated in an outpatient clinic. And again, multiple sources of documents improve accuracy. So once I get your request to do the competency evaluation, I want to think about where am I going to do this. It's kind of an obvious thing, but sometimes I actually will have an option where I might be able, I've done, I think, one or two, one of Amanda's clients actually in my office, or I might have to do it in the jail setting, but you want to think where you're going to do this exam. And it is ethical, it is kosher, to have the lawyer present during the evaluation if everybody agrees. Now, I think I might have done that one time in 3 years here, and I have to be honest, I think part of it, it's just very difficult to arrange these things logistically, and it takes time and money. So it's not done that commonly, but it's something to consider. And then you want to think about, do you want to tape this thing? So, you know, you have to think about whether or not you're allowed to bring a camera into the jail. They probably would not be real happy about that. And then you want to think about if you actually can smuggle in some recording equipment, or you're doing it in your office, what effect is that going to have on the person? Because it increases anxiety if I know that I have a camera on me. So that might not really be a good maneuver. So that's just something that needs to be thought through with the examiner and the lawyer prior to the evaluation. And I'm not trained in psychology, but I felt like I needed to address this briefly just because it is an important point that a lot of psychologists use psych testing when they go in to do the competency evaluation. And to make it really simple, like overly simplifying this thing, there's three types of psych testing, which the synonymous name for psych testing is a tool or a standardized method. So the first type of psych test that might be used for competency is called ideographic, and that simply means that I might have a vignette and I might read this thing off the piece of paper, and it might be a little story about somebody committing a crime or allegedly committing a crime and what happens in the courtroom. So you read this thing to the defendant or the client, and then you get some feedback and you rate them. So that would be an ideographic psych test. And one example would be, these have a tremendous amount of acronyms that are hard to read, but this is an FITR, Fitness Interview Test Revised. And then there's the nomothetic types of psych testing for competency. Those are the more common ones, and they purport to have some objectivity. So the psychologist goes in there, and they sit there for an hour, and they ask a bunch of questions, kind of like a personality test or an IQ test, and then they just total up the scores, and they get a rating, and then they can give you a percent, and they say, well, there's an 82% chance that this person is competent. And it sounds very scientific and objective, but I'm going to kind of show you another way to think about that. And then finally, you might do a psychological test for a special population. So I've actually seen some psychiatrists in this system who actually, I don't do it, but another psychiatrist I've seen her do the CAST-MR, and it's a relatively brief psych test in order to test for intellectual deficit. So what are the upsides and downsides of using psych testing? Because not everybody uses them. Well, an upside is that it is standardized. So you can give a percent that has some meaning. If you come up with, for instance, you know, there's a 5% chance this person is competent, that's in all, in the whole balance of the equation, they probably are not competent. Or if they're 99%, they probably are competent. But you have everything in between. And the problem is, I don't know exactly how you lawyers think about it, but in medicine, we think about something called a gold standard. So a gold standard, as an example, would be if you're doing a test to check how many calories a person takes in a day or something like that, there's a device called a bomb calorimeter. It's an old-time device. So you stick all the food in kind of like a microwave oven, and it goes poof, and then you know exactly how many calories there are, and that's totally 100% accurate. So that would be a gold standard to compare to. Nowadays, everybody has an app for everything. So somebody has now designed a new app to estimate calories so you can compare the app to the bomb calorimeter, which is the gold standard. Whereas in terms of competence, by definition, there cannot be a gold standard because there's human beings doing the examination. You have different statutes in different states. So in the research on competency, in order to try to come up with a gold standard, it's been proposed to have what would be called a blue ribbon panel. So you might get three eminent lawyers from the audience or University of Texas, and if all three of those people could actually agree that a person is competent or incompetent, that would be the gold standard, and now I can compare my psychological tests to that gold standard. So what would be, we talked about the actual testing. Now a person is, you're actually designating a person, whether it's a psychologist or psychiatrist in this system, to go in and do an evaluation on your client. Now, who are you gonna choose, a psychiatrist or a psychologist? So there's always an upside and downside to everything. And I would have to admit, as I said, most psychiatrists are not trained to do psychological testing, so if you want some really sophisticated psych testing, you're probably not going to send in your psychiatrist. And nowadays, most psychiatrists are not. I happen to have been trained in therapy, and that would be showing my age, because in the 1960s, I think the statistic is that 95 percent of the teaching in a psychiatric residency was teaching the psychiatrist how to do therapy, because there were like five medications, that was it. So we had a lot of time to learn about therapy in my day, but nowadays it's totally flipped. So nowadays, only 5% of the time in a psych residency is the psychiatrist training taught to know how to do therapy. So most psychologists still are taught how to do therapy. So if there's an issue about that person's therapy that has to do with their competency, you probably want to send in a psychologist. And then on the other side of the coin, most psychologists do not prescribe medications. There are some psychologists prescribe medications. It depends on what state we're in, and it depends on, there's certain what they call exceptions. So if you have an Indian reservation and it's really underly served, then legally you can send in a psychologist to give meds as long as that person is trained. But in general, in a city like Austin, most psychologists do not prescribe meds. So if your case revolves quite a bit around medication, or that has to do with restoring the person, you might tend to use the psychiatrist. And then I have to say, I think we have a better training in physiology than the psychologists, although nowadays more and more psychologists are learning anatomy and physiology. But again, just for this, I'm not saying these are any hard and fast rules, but just in your thinking, if you have a client that has a particular type of chemical addiction, you might send in an expert on that. So I put in the asterisk, the moral is, if possible, to pick your evaluator based on your client's clinical condition as it relates to their legal situation. That was the shortest I could make that sentence. And Claudia was my legal assistant, so she said I have to give her credit for this slide. She put that hammer and book in there. And this is a derivation of the actual statute for competency in Texas, which I'm sure most of you have memorized. And it states that to find a defendant incompetent, they must either have what is defined in the statute as a mental illness, or the person has to have an intellectual disability, and again, in the old days, mental retardation. So it has to be one or the other. So if the person, the way the statute reads, if the person has a diagnosis of what used to be called a psychopath, now it's called a sociopath, so if they're a psychopathic sociopath, that person does not, by definition, have a mental illness. So you'd have to read the statute to find out how it defines mental illness. Or the person might have a low IQ, so it'd be a person with intellectual disability, but they must have one of those two. And then if the competency evaluation actually shows up in a court of law in Texas, the fact that the person is incompetent, so the defense is trying to prove that the defendant is incompetent, that has to be done by a preponderance of the evidence. So for anybody out there who's not a lawyer, I think that's usually defined as greater than 50%. And the issue of competency can be raised anytime during the trial. So the trial might be going along, you know, very nicely, and then all of a sudden the person is obviously hallucinating, and you can say, "Judge, excuse me, can we have somebody evaluate this client or this defendant for competency?" And then it's kind of a common sense thing, but in the statute, if everybody agrees, so the judge and both lawyers say, definitely, this, again, using the common jargon, this person is really out to lunch, they have no idea what's going on, and everybody agrees, then you don't have to have a trial. That person is just declared to be incompetent. And I think I put this in the handout, and I went to Amanda's office before this. She actually has a much better decision tree, but that just shows, I'm not trained in this, but there's a certain order that competency goes through with the legal system. So once, I already covered psych testing, so once you've decided whether or not you're going to use psych testing, what do you actually do to evaluate that person for competency? Well, you have to find out whether or not they actually can understand what the proceedings are about. So again, if you had somebody from another culture or another country, you can use the test and retest strategy. So if I'm the evaluator, I might say, well, in your country, do you have a such thing as a judge or a jury? No, I really don't. And then I explain, well, the judge makes certain decisions and the jury might be 12 people who decide whether you're guilty. And I kind of give them a brief synopsis. So later on in the exam, then I ask them, by the way, do you understand what a judge is? So that's called the teach and the retest strategy. And then a higher level of cognition over and above understanding is called appreciation. So understanding means that I realize that at the end of my trial, I might be declared guilty or innocent. Whereas appreciation means, how does this apply to me? So it's kind of a dumb example. If I go out and I steal something or if I murder somebody and it's caught and 28 people have that on their cell phones, it's very likely I'm going to be declared guilty. So in regards to my particular case, I need to be able to appreciate that, and that might cause me to decide with my lawyer that I'm going to do a plea. So appreciation is understanding, but applied to my particular scenario. And this is just another way of, I don't know how it is in law, but we're very fond of acronyms. So I'm going to kind of skip this because we've talked about most of these things, but you it's a way of kind of structuring your competency exam. And this is a key point, that when competency reports are checked by the expert, the number one problem is that the person who does the report does not explain adequately or enough. So if I do a competency report and I feel the person is incompetent, I need to explain what that person's diagnosis is, what are their symptoms, and how do those symptoms or how do those deficits in functioning actually cause that person to be incompetent per the statute. And I'll go over that a little bit more near the end. So now I'm kind of wrapping up my evaluation, I've actually spent 60 minutes at the jail and the person has actually sat through it. But before I say to the prisoner, thank you very much, I need to think about either formally or informally, is this a case of dissimulation? So that's a fancy way of saying, is the person faking it? And there's two ways the person can fake it in terms of our jargon. One way is feigning. So feigning would mean I want to be declared incompetent for some reason, so I'm pretending I don't know what a judge is, or I'm pretending I don't know what a trial is. So I'm faking my abilities to be competent, whereas malingering means that I'm faking symptoms. So I'm telling the person evaluating me, oh, well, you know, I mean, I know you're out to get me, and I'm hearing voices, and you know, the TV is talking to me. And none of that is really true, but I'm making it seem like I have symptoms that would cause me to be incompetent. And I have an article. I've gone to a review course for several years, where this guy, he's kind of the world's expert on malingering, he gives a talk, so I gave you an article on that, so I don't have to explain that. And then again, I mentioned that, I know it's not true in this system, but if you have a private case, now I've evaluated the defendant or the inmate. If this is a private case, I need to ask the lawyer, do you want me to type this up? Because you would know much more about this than I would, but I believe the lawyer can choose not to have me make a report. If my report may not be favorable to that lawyer, then I stop right there. I don't have to type up the report. So that's an important step to make if you're doing a private competency evaluation. And then there's a whole kind of a argument about whether or not the evaluator should give what's called the conclusory opinion. So the conclusory opinion would be, I basically say at the end of my report, yes, I believe to a reasonable degree of medical certainty they are competent, or I believe to a reasonable medical probability they are incompetent. So I've kind of made a legal conclusion, and there's an argument to be said for me not to do that because it really doesn't offer any new information. It's unnecessary. And then the argument is that I'm not trained legally, so as a clinician, I should not be offering my legal opinion. Whereas on the other side of the coin, and I'll show you the statistics, over 90% of the time, the court will agree with my evaluation. So if you're going to agree with my evaluation anyway, and let's say I've been in this court a number of times, the judge knows me, he knows I write a reasonable report, and it saves the judge and the court time and money, so I say they're incompetent, they say fine, let's move on, we agree with you. And then the other argument in favor of me saying my conclusion is that you don't have to agree with what I say. So I might write this fabulous 10-page report, and I think I've brilliantly said clinically and legally why that person is incompetent, and I shouted in my report they're incompetent. Well, you as the judge might say, no, we don't agree with you. So that's an argument in favor of why not say it, because the court does not have to agree with me. And again, as I said, the courts usually agree. And just in researching this thing out, this is just my own thinking, and I'd be interested in your input at some point. But I think some of it's a matter of semantics. Because if you have, to make an extreme case, if you have a really flaming schizophrenic, they're obviously delusional, they're obviously hearing voices, they obviously are not rational, they are not competent, So what's the difference if I say all of that and I don't say those words at the end, yes, I thus believe they're not competent? It's kind of an obvious conclusion. So in researching this out, I found out that my training, I think, as a physician, and I used to be in internal medicine way back when, and somehow I just learned over time this term. It's called treatment recommendations, or in the old days it would be a SOAP note. So it would be you walk in and I say, subjectively, you say this, objectively, I see this, A is assessed, P is planned. So I've been trained to think in terms of treatment recommendations, whereas I found in the psychology, I think the psychologists are actually smarter than we are, or at least they're more intellectual, so they love to call this thing a dispositional objective, which seems it's kind of a big word. But the bottom line is, if the person is not competent, can you restore them to competency, and if so, how? So you have to think about as I said, in one of those landmark cases and in the statute, the term is used, they have to be able to be restored in the foreseeable future. And again, you would know the statute better than I would, but I saw somewhere in the statute, somewhere down the line, they talk about 1 year. So I think that's a reasonable period of time. So I'm going to be thinking about, can I get this person possibly in a hospital? Can I put enough medications in their system within a year that they're actually competent? So the point that I'm trying to make is, it's not just a matter of saying, here's some medications. I'm just going to use medications. I'm going to throw medications at this person. I'm going to put Prozac in their oatmeal. That probably is the main way I'm going to restore them to competency, but that's not the only thing that I'm going to do. So I'm going to walk you through what else can you do other than give the person medications to restore them to competency. But first, I just want to touch on the medications in terms of the legal decisions and precedents. So if I recommend medications to restore somebody to competency, the terminology is they must be likely to make them competent in the foreseeable future. And I want to use the least invasive means, which I think is a term that's in a lot of legal decision. So the least invasive or the least restrictive means. So that an example of that would be somebody who is, say, elderly, and they're very, very depressed. They're so depressed that they can't remember anything. So in the old days, we would call that a pseudo-dementia. So I have an 80-year-old person. They're so depressed, they have no idea where they are. They look like they have Alzheimer's. And I go to the judge, or I write in my report, I go, you know, really, statistically, the best treatment for this person is they need to have electroshock therapy. That's really the best treatment for a depression and a geriatric. And in that particular case, just as an example, the court might say, no, that seems a little invasive to wheel this guy to Seton Hospital every other day and put electrodes on their brain and give them a shock. That seems a little invasive. Let's just go with the Prozac. So that's just one way of thinking in terms of this treatment. And then you have to be able to not unduly prejudice the person's rights. And again, this is more of a legal thing, but I think there's some landmark decisions where a person was actually given medications who was pleading insanity because they were really wacky when they committed the crime, and now they're looking really good in court. Now they're on their Prozac, they're on their Haldol, they're on their Abilify, and they look perfectly sane and perfectly calm. So now the jury is thinking, like, I can't even envision what that person was really like when they were off their meds. So that's supposed to be a consideration in giving medications to restore. And then finally, the opposite side of the same coin can happen. So I give the person medications, now they're looking really good, they're thinking really good, but now they're basically slobbering on the floor and shuffling. So they're not really looking that great that way. So I'm not supposed to give medications that have such terrible side effects that will prejudice the hearing. And my viewpoint of this, again, maybe showing my age, I've kind of lived through the golden oldie drugs that we really don't use anymore. So the newer meds really do have a lot less side effects, so it's not that much of a problem. And then I think that this is the way to restore that a lot of people do not think about, whether lawyers or evaluators. So the other thing you can do to restore is not, the previous slide was change the defendant, this is change the demands. So there are simple fixes that can be done in the courtroom. And there has been cases. I might be a person who, I believe that all women are out to get me. The men are just fine, but it's those women who are gonna do me in. And in this particular system, what I found, the good thing about this system is it's very flexible. So you could just switch lawyers, the man for the woman, and now I've basically been restored to competency. And then another really obvious example is a person who needs a deaf person who needs sign language. And this is a little bit complicated by a guy, Richard Bonney, and maybe you would know, or somebody could tell me after the talk, because I tried Googling LLB and I still couldn't figure it out, but I think it's somebody who has some super great law degree or something like that. But this guy writes a lot about competency. He's out of the University of Virginia. And everything that I've told you already, he's really saying nothing new, but he says it in a slightly different way. So he talks about that in order for somebody to be declared competent, they have to meet what he calls the foundational construct. So in simple language, he's just saying that person has to be able to understand what is going on. So if you have remember the two prongs that I talked about? So if the person does not understand what's going on, you really, in a sense, don't have to go any further. They're definitely incompetent. But if they pass that test, they do understand basically what's going on. Now, I, as an evaluator, I want to think about their decisional competence. And I don't know if you can remember back to one of the first slides we talked about how autonomy is very important philosophically in terms of competency. So I have to be able to autonomously make decisions as the trial goes on. I need to make a decision based on what my lawyer says, do I want a jury? Do I want a judge? Do I want a plea? So there's a lot of obvious decisions that might go on during the trial, and I have to be able to adequately make those decisions to be competent. And this is basically a rehash that if I'm evaluating somebody and I'm typing up my report, I need to be able to explain what is their diagnosis, what is their psychopathology, and how does that relate to the statute. And this is the Bonnie criteria, but this is simplified. So if I'm the person designated to evaluate competency, I want to know, first of all, what is required of the defendant? So again, these are kind of like dumb examples. But if I have one case where it's going to be approximately a 1 hour trial because I stole something from 7-Eleven, that is a lot different than if you have, again, I'm showing my age, but an O.J. Simpson trial that goes on for like 18 months, that obviously is going to require much more stamina from the defendant. And Bonnie calls, he has kind of an umbrella term. He's talking about we need to evaluate what he calls the psycho-legal abilities. So in talking about restorability, and way back, I hate to admit it, way back when, I majored in probability and statistics, which all I can remember now is algebra. But this is, I thought, kind of an interesting proposition for any of you that have any kind of math background. And you kind of have to take my word for it. Both of these statements are totally true. So number one, the evaluator's ability to predict restoration is poor. So my prediction is poor. And number two, the accuracy rate of competency to stand trial restoration within 1 year is 80%. So does anybody know how that's possible? Or so obviously I set you up on that one, leading you down the garden paths. But it's a statistical aberration because 80 to 90% of people that are incompetent that are sent to be restored will be restored. So again, it's kind of a dumb example. If I'm really busy and I figure I need a little extra cash, so the next 100 evaluations you send to me, I don't actually go to the jail, like I'm too busy, and I decide to just write up a bogus report. And I know that most of you probably just read the end where it says finding, so I'm just gonna put competent 100 times. Competent. Well, 80 of those 100, I will be correct. I will be totally correct because it's a statistic. But where I will fail is the 20% of people that could be incompetent. Those people, I have no predictive capacity. So if anybody wants to talk to me about that at the end, but just you'll kind of have to take my word for it. And these statistics, again, hopefully based on what you all already know, and most of you would know much better than I would legally, but based on some of what I've said, this is common sense. So the people who are predicted to be restored, so the person is incompetent, and I think they probably will be able to be restored in the foreseeable future, those people obviously have less serious diagnoses. So if I have somebody with mental retardation or intellectual developmental disability with an IQ of 32 and they're effectively operating on the level of a three-year-old, it probably is not gonna matter how long I stick them in Austin State Hospital. They're not gonna gain a whole lot of IQ points. And then on the other hand, this seems a little counterintuitive, but this is my thinking on it. The more serious violent criminal histories actually are predicted to be more restorable. So how is that possible? Well, what I was thinking, I think I was in this very courtroom way back when, and there was some defendant, and this guy kind of like is somewhat typical of the system. I think he had been in the revolving door at least six or seven times, so he was incompetent, he was using drugs, and he was schizophrenic, and he was stuck in the state hospital, and he got a year's worth of treatment, and he was declared competent, and by that time he had served enough time, so he was let go, and then he went off of his meds, and I'm sure most of you know that scenario. So if you think about it, somebody with a very serious or violent criminal history, they've probably already been restored 8 times. So the 9th time is very predictable. And then on the other side of the coin, people who have a long-standing psychosis, who have had a lot of long psych hospitalizations, they tend to be predicted to be not restored. Or again, you have the mental retardation example. And again, this is something I've already gone over, but the most common complaint that lawyers or judges have about our reports is that we just say something very blatantly, and we don't really explain it. So if you look at the second arrow, evaluators often describe the competency domain as, quote, impaired, but go no further. So I just say that person cannot possibly relate to their attorney, but I don't explain the reason that is. That would not be a very good report. Or another thing that commonly happens in the report would be the third arrow. So I might say, I talk with the defendant in jail, and he feels that the judge, that the jury, that his lawyer, et cetera, they're all part of a plot against him. So common sense would tell you they're not competent, but I have to be able to link that up and say, thus, based on the statute, that person could not possibly rationally know what's going on in the courtroom. So it's important to link up their symptoms with the actual legal statute. And this would be a picture of me typing out the report. And I wish I had thought of this, but somebody wrote that I should be typing up my report thinking that, you know, even though I know most everybody in this courtroom has very high IQ points, you may not have a whole lot of clinical training. So I should be careful about the amount of jargon and lingo that I put into my reports. And then finally, I was going to put it in a pitch for the intellectually disabled defendant. And what happens, what is not uncommon there is if you have a person and they're walking around with a moderately low IQ, so they're clocking in at an IQ of 68 with 100 being normal, so I'm essentially operating like I'm in sixth grade or something like that, and I'm living my life that way. So now I'm a somewhat intellectually impaired person, and I begin to learn either explicitly or implicitly. I start hiding my retardation, so I become a very quiet person. I don't engage with people a whole lot. So those are the type of clients that you lawyers out there might have, where you have to have a very high index of suspicion, because ironically, some lawyers have told me, "Hey, that's my best client. Like that client, they never argue with me. They always agree with me. They hardly say anything, so I don't have to spend a whole lot of time with them." But the lawyer hasn't thought about, "Hey, maybe this is due to their intellectually disabled." So anyway, I will end there if anybody wants to make comments or questions. Thank you.